And I've got just a couple of disclaimers just to say before I begin. So time might be the friend of grassland restoration, but I can tell you it's not the friend of a PhD student. My results are very preliminary, but also I've used tube stock planting in a lot of cases, so I'm not advocating. Obviously I've heard a lot about direct seedings the way to go, not tube stock, but I needed adult plants quickly. So don't tune out when you hear the word tube stock and go, oh, she's got no idea what she's doing, and I'm not listening. But yeah, it's a way to speed things along. Okay, so I'll get into it. So yes, my talk's titled Native Grass Establishment and the Battle with the Invasives Occurs Below Ground. So the battlefield that I'm working at is at Para Woodlands, and Tom and Dragosh are here, and they can tell you a lot more about Para Woodlands than I can. But it's just outside of Gawler, and I'm focused on a very small part that I've called an old field. So this is, it's cultivated, it's been cultivated for decades and decades, and when it was then donated, it's been overrun with weeds. So the farming stopped for, I think it's around 2003. So it's been overrun with weeds. There's no natives in the seed bank or in surrounding it. They're not going to come back on their own, and so we need active restoration, and weeds is a big problem, as well as fertilizer that's retained in the soil, so increased nutrients there. So that's the battlefield. And the opponents. So we have invasive annual grasses as the main opponent, or the main weed. So there's plenty of arena, it's the most dominant, definitely. I've also looked to figure out longlimbs, so less dominant, but very present. There are some other broadleaves and things as well. Very weedy, but mostly looking at the invasive annual grasses. And of course, our natives. They're the things we want to bring back in. I'm looking at the perennial, so we want grasses that are longer lived, deeper root systems, and yes, they are a bit slower growing, as has been mentioned. So they're the opponents, and the route to victory is about knowing your enemy. So that's why forums like this are really important, to share information, but also research is really important, and understanding the mechanisms underlining the restoration work that everyone's doing. So I'm going to focus on three aspects. So nutrient availability in the soil, soil microbes, a bit of a hot topic, and resource use. So I'll explain that a bit further, and then I'm going to go into some experiments that I've run. So nutrient availability has been a bit of a topic. So we all know it's not the best for native grasses. So in this case, there's retained fertilizer, retained nutrients from the fertilizer. And so you have increased nutrients. The invasive grasses are really good at taking up that nutrients, fast growing, they take over, and that's not so good. So a sort of indirect effect there on the native grasses. And what happens with the invasive grasses, as you've heard throughout the forum, is they can take up a lot of that nutrients, they grow really quickly, and then they die and they return that nutrients. So they actually maintain that higher nutrients. So that's one problem for restoration. And yes, soil microbes. We have a microbiologist in the room, so I'm going to just give a bit of a rundown of what you need to understand in my research. So yes, soil microbes are really important for plant growth. Not always beneficial though. So there are tight relationships with plants they need to grow, but they're also pathogens, and microbes also play a role in ecosystem services like aeration of soils and controlling nutrient cycles. So they play a huge role. Weed invasions can also change the microbial communities. So they can do that by changes in the organic matter that they then return back to the soil. They can release things from their roots, so they're called exudates, and they have different root structures as well that can, be different habitats for different types of microbes. So I'm interested in how these changes from weed invasions, but also farming practices in old fields, how that might have altered the microbial community, and maybe altered too much for restoring, putting our native grasses back in. And then brings me to the last sort of concept, I guess, behind my research, is about resource use. So The idea here is that successful restoration can be achieved by selecting native species that have a diversity of functional traits. So functional traits are ways that they grow with times of year or resources that they use. And the idea is that if you have a diversity of functional traits, invasives will be less likely to establish if their niches are not occupied. So in the grass world, what I'm looking at is, I guess, the functional groups of C3 and C4 grasses. So this is somewhat of an interesting screen and growth. This is very much diagrammatic, so, you know, it's not in a very place. But you have the C4s in red, they're obviously more active over summer or in spring summer. And natives here in blue, C3 natives are more active over winter spring. And what's happening is invasive C3s, they occur really early in the season. So this year they come up as soon as there's some rain or growth in summer. They'll be slow to take off. Then they really do sort of take over and they get a bit of a head start before the C3 natives. So the idea of incorporating C3 and C4 in planting so that resources are being used pretty much all year round, leaving less space for invasives. So these three, I guess, concepts I've put into three experiments. So the first one is site preparation. We've heard a lot about this, so I'm probably going to skim over this one pretty quickly. But my idea was which weed management techniques can reduce the nutrient availability in the soil and improve native grass growth. So that's one I'll be talking about, so that's about soil nutrients. Then I've got an experiment looking at the microbial communities, so how do the microbial communities influence restoration outcomes. And then I'm going to go into one about the planting strategy. So if you can incorporate functional diversity and resource use into planting, planting strategies make vegetative communities more resilient to wind invasion. Okay, so these are the three experiments I'm going to try and get through. So site preparation, we all know how important it is, going to be a topic over the forum. My aim is to understand the mechanisms involved in successful restoration. And the application is, again, about reducing that nutrient availability and weed competition and tipping the balance to favour natives. So they're the aims and what I did. So I had my different weed management techniques. So I slashed but removed that biomass, so it's probably more akin to grazing, I guess, on a much smaller scale. So slashing is easier. But getting rid of that biomass, burning, and scalping, hot topic. Again, and then I've had a control. And adding carbon source. So we've heard about this a bit. So by adding a carbon source, it's food for the microbes in the soil. They can eat that up and eat up some nutrients as well. That's the idea behind. So I added sugar and sawdust mixed together. So a bit different. I'd like to know what rates you used. So fair bit of sugar. And then so this is the, I guess, the weed management in 3x3, and then I split with the carbon on one side and no carbon on the other there. And then, so again, I used tube stock and direct seeding. I'm just going to present tube stock data today. Because this is very hot off the press and I haven't got the chance to analyse it all. But yeah, I added tube stock on one half and seeds on the other half there. So this was just one season. Again, I don't have a lot of time in PhD. And so I've measured, taken soil samples to have a look at that changes in nutrients, and I've got some extracted some DNA to have a look at how the microbial communities change, but that's still in analysis as well. And then of course the successful weed management. So I'm presenting the weed biomass at the end of the season today, but also looking at what weeds have come up. I was on the ground looking at seedling emergence and mortality fortnightly over the whole season, and tube stock survival and the biomass at the end of the season. So, what's a grass? Because I'm a scientist. So this is all about soil nutrients. So did we actually reduce the nutrients? And I've just pulled out nitrate. But this one, all these graphs, next few graphs, all look the same. So we have the treatments along the bottom here, no carbon in red, and added carbon in blue. So you can see that nitrate was pretty consistently reduced by adding my sugar and sawdust mix. How do you say that? So yes, we've achieved that goal in the case of nitrate at least. Then when I looked at phosphorus, there wasn't an effect of carbon, maybe a little bit here, but that scalping treatment has significantly reduced the phosphorus. And I took the top 5 centimetres of soil. We've seen that that's where most of it lies. So not all that surprising, but pretty neat result. So how were the natives affected by these treatments? And this is just the tube stock growth at the end of the season. And they did really well in the scalping. By adding carbon, they're not quite as well. There could be reduction in the nutrients. Scalping's doing really well. What about the weeds? So on the half that I added tube stock, scalping once again really stands out. And adding carbon with the slash here has reduced the weed by half. And on the side that we seeded, obviously the biomass of the weeds is a bit more increased. The natives weren't as competitive, so the control up here is huge. But you can see by adding that carbon has reduced the weeds, and again, the scalping, of course, is coming out a winner. So I'll just quickly sum up. This has been spoken about a lot, but at least in my experiment, the carbon addition reduced the nitrate in the soil and has managed to reduce the biomass of the weeds. And the scalping was most successful at reducing the phosphorus, increasing native grass growth, and reducing the weed biomass. And I have a lot more data to come on this, so my seeding emergence and mortality data, so this is all little pegs where I've been out and marked native grass seedlings. So they were there and just haven't had a chance to get to that. So that brings me to my soil microbes experiment. So in this experiment I compared the performance of a native and invasive grass species grown with soil microbial communities from an old field environment that I've already mentioned and a remnant grassland also a parallel land. And my questions were, does one invasive grass benefit from the invasion of another invasive? So I used the less dominant in this experiment, so that's the Lolia, compared to the Arena. And do remnant microbial communities benefit from native grass growth and establishment? So this was a greenhouse experiment, and I had some commercially bought soil, standing loam, and I autoclaved that, so steam sterilised it, and I took some aside for the control, and the rest I inoculated with a small amount, around 20% of soil from the oilfield area and the remnant area, and by using a small amount, I'm trying to dilute the differences in the nutrients and just to sort of get the microbes in there. And so yeah, I grew the lolium as I mentioned, and I had the wallaby and speedgrass species, and just for 4 months. So were the microbial communities different like I expected? And here is PCA plot, and all you need to take from this plot is that points that are close together are more similar in the species that are present than points that are further apart. And you can see a pretty obvious clear divide here. So you've got remnant in blue and oldfield. So yep, the bacterial species present are different as we'd expect. And same story with the fungi species. So that's good because I've done the experiment by this point, so it's nice to know they were different. And then looking at the mortality of the plants, so we we have the wallaby in blue and the spear grass in orange, and I guess the wallaby in here in green. So the natives were more sensitive overall, higher mortality. Expect the weeds would do pretty well. We all know how well they do. And interestingly, here with the oldfield microbes, both native species had a huge amount of mortality, so we're talking 50 to 60%, which, quite staggering. But it was sterile, with not a lot of mortality. And Starfire was pretty sensitive there with the remnant in the orange, still with remnant, but wallaby grass had no mortality when the remnant microbes were present. So, certainly when you compare to the old field, remnant microbes are doing pretty well. That's mortality of survival. Let's have a look at growth. So the weed, there's I guess lower growth with sterile, so the weeds do like to have microbes, but they're not really fussy between the old field and remnant, which I guess not that surprising. But no advantage of like I expected with the old field that's already been overrun with weeds there, so I thought that might have increased growth there, but nope, they're not fussy. Now, this was the more sensitive species in the mortality graphs. You can see the ones that did survive in the remnant did better than the other two treatments. So the Starker ones, increased growth there with remnant microbes. And the wallaby grass, they really didn't take off. So there's not a lot of mortality if you remember from the other graph, but there was a blade of grass, maybe two blades of grass. So clearly they need some microbes, but the growth here actually wasn't significantly different between old field and remnant. Probably needs a few more retrofits. Mortality here, but some reliance on microbes definitely. So just to quickly summarise that, the weed response, so weeds had the lowest mortality overall, as we'd expect, and they weren't too fussy with which microbes were present, but there was some reliance on microbes. The natives, so they had higher mortality in the old field, so quite sensitive, and so that could be pretty nasty microbes may be present in the old field soil, and there was increased growth with remnant microbes, particularly for the spear grass. So incorporating, this sort of came up yesterday, but incorporating microbial inoculation into restoration programs may be really beneficial. So pretty exciting, and definitely need a bit more research, but some pretty clear results. So the last one I'm going to talk to you about is about this planting strategies idea. So is the resilience of revegetated communities increased by functional diversity and also with planting density, so trying to take up those resources. And how did the natives respond to these different planting strategies? So I had weeded plots to look at the competition between natives. So we're putting them at really high density, how do they cope? And the whole idea was that sort of resource use. So I've had a look at soil moisture every 3 hours for over 12 months actually. I've got at least one whole year's data. And also looking at the nutrients and those different functional groups. So back to my lovely diagram. I'm using an Ostrostyper and a wallaby grass species, and the two C4s there, Heniobogan and Bermuda. So that's the two sort of functional groups that I'm looking at. And when you put all those ideas together, what you have is C4s on their own and then C3 and 4s together, and the different densities. So I've got really quite high density at 44 plants per square metre, and then my low is 20 plants per square metre. And then to look at the native grass performance, I've got that weeded and unweeded just to see how they cope growing together. So yeah, that overall comes to 12 treatments, 6 reps, 72 pots. So it got pretty big pretty quick, but I'm pretty ambitious. But unfortunately, the results are still to come. I'm in the middle of harvesting now. I've still got 4 pots to go, but I took a short break to come and present. And then there's over 2,000 bags that I need to weigh. It's individually bagged all of the native plants. So yes, you have to stay tuned, but I wanted to maybe start up this discussion about how we're planting and how we're making our communities more, our vegetative communities more resilient. But I do have some expected results, so I think there will be a trade-off between that resilience to weed invasion and the competition between natives. So there may be fewer weeds in a high density, but other natives, you know, smaller, maybe not having as much of seed output as they could be. And so overall, I expect there'll be fewer weeds when the C3 and C4 grown together because of that resource use. But when I've been harvesting, I've noticed the C3's just boomed. Like, we've had so much rain this winter, and the pots where it's just C3, they're amazing. And they've had an extra season. It would have been great to have another summer for the C4s, but by that point, the weeds are all dead. I get a lot of biomass. So it was sort of a catch-22, and again, being a PhD student, couldn't really do a long-term study, but it's certainly going to provide some preliminary results and get the conversation started. So I'm excited about it, and a bit of an advertisement, maybe I could come back when I have my results. So just to summarise, really just to be thinking about this sort of below-ground restoration into our rough ground efforts. So it may have really huge implications. We'll be talking about nutrients a lot, but also the microbial community. We want to create conditions where natives can be victorious over the weeds. And yeah, thinking about farming practices, what's happened before, and that resource use all year round, and leaving less gaps for the weeds. So I've got a lot of people to thank, and a couple in the room, the Powerful Lands crew, of course, my supervisors, and a lot of people who've been helping out with my project. And also keep in touch. I've obviously got a lot more to say and a lot more data to come, and I'd really like to share that with you. And, yeah, so thank you for listening.